in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. As your word is coming forth today, in the mighty name of Jesus, my eyes are enlightened. In the name of Jesus, I'm not remaining where I have been. Your word is coming me to, is coming to take me to a higher place. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, O Lord. What is the expectation? Voices to the Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, they looked unto him, and they were not ashamed. Their faces were enlightened, and they were not ashamed. In the name of Jesus, you have heard that them that go from they spoke from strength to strength. Every one of them appeared before God in Zion. In the name of Jesus, this day I receive my own healing. I receive my own deliverance. In the mighty name of Jesus, my eyes are open. Light is coming into me, and every darkness disappears in the name of Jesus. We thank you and we bless your holy name. Lift your voice and appreciate the Lord. Give him all the glory, even as the word is coming forth in the name of Jesus. Lord, we say thank you. We give you all the adoration and magnify your name, O God. Hallelujah. Receive all the glory, dear Lord. We magnify your name, O dear Father.
We exalt your name. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we gather before you again today. We leave you to receive from you.
Yes.
And we know, Lord, the expectation of the righteous shall not be cut off. Lord, we know that to say whatever thing we desire, if we believe and we pray about it, we shall obtain it. And all of us here, Lord, we are praying for something. And we believe that today we shall receive all encounter in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
See the book of Obadiah 1:17, they say, upon one time there shall be deliverance, Lord. And Lord, there shall be holiness, and the people shall possess their possessions.
Yes.
Let everyone here believe in God for possession of one thing. Is it spiritual? Is it financial? Is it physical? Is it mental? Lord, give it to them in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And every one of us who's streaming on us online, Lord, also with them at the point of day. Let the same power present here to heal and restore be there for them in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Lord, we celebrate you. Amen. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
In the name of Habariako. I'm happy to see you. Amen.
Amen.
I can't see a letter from you, but I believe I'll see it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
May I have your sisters, kings, and queens in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Are you excited to be here?
Yes.
Are you happy?
Yes.
Hallelujah. It was a week of English. Has any one of us experienced English? Hallelujah. I told you at the end of the week that this is your week of increase, and I believe most of us have experienced increase one way or another in the name of Jesus. Now, this month we have been looking at cultivating the attitude of prayer. Cultivating what?
The attitude of prayer.
Cultivating the attitude of prayer. Amen. And I believe by the grace of God, I'll take you through for the past two sessions, Sundays, whatever I've discussed in brief, before I take you through the word of God for today in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Cultivating the attitude of what?
Prayer.
Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 to 11. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 to 11. Please have your Bibles. We are a word believing church. Amen. We believe in the word of God. So the word of God is the fact of everything. Amen. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 to 11. It says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Amen. Finally, my brethren. Finally. Hallelujah. When he says that, the scripture says finally, meaning that in conclusion, you should be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. But someone may be asking me, what is the power of his might? What is this power of his might? The power of his might is the manifestation of his greatness, the manifestation of God's greatness. When you see God coming through for you, you will experience the power of his might. Am I saying the truth? And that one you consider from the book of Ephesians chapter 1 verse 19. The Bible says, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power towards us? Who believe? So there's an exceeding greatness. Amen. There's an exceeding what?
Greatness.
Number two, the reality of where you are positioned. Amen. Listen to me. The power of his might is expressed by knowing where you are positioned. Where are you sitting with Christ Jesus? Above principalities and what?
Powers.
Amen. So then you realize that you experience the power of his mind. Most people are Christians, but they don't have the mental identity that they are Christians. Christianity is not about crisis. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
You are above. So you must know where you are positioned. Amen. You are above principalities and what? Powers. What they say is a casting down, you shall be saying is a what?
Amen.
Amen. When they are saying they are sick, you are saying you are healed. Amen.
Amen.
That's what it means. Because by his strength you are what?
Amen.
When they say they are poor, you say you are rich. Amen. Why? In 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, he says, he died poor that he will be made what? You see, that's why knowing where your position. Do you know where your position? When you know where your position, your experience is marked. According to the book of Ephesians chapter 1, verse 21, the Bible says, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in the world, but also which is true. So you're not only positioned above everything today, also tomorrow in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Number three, by accessing the manifold wisdom of God. Amen. The power is meant is when you operate in a particular form of wisdom that nobody else can operate in. Amen. Manifold wisdom of what? You can be a chef, but how you cook, everyone wants your food. Amen. Wisdom of God is how you put the spices. Hallelujah. That people, there's a man that you can cook that everyone wants from you. But it takes the wisdom of God. Hallelujah. Because the wisdom of God knows the taste parts of people. You understand? People are dynamic, people change, but God knows how people change. God is so current, he's the same yesterday, today, and so he knows about tomorrow. So the power is not about you knowing the manifold wisdom of God. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 10. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 10. To the intent that now and to the principalities and powers in heavenly places, you must be known by the church, the manifold wisdom of God. And lastly, experiencing power. Power over witches, power over generational embargoes. Amen. People in your family suffer a particular thing. You must have, that's why you must continue in prayer. You need power. Amen. People are educated, but they have nothing to show. People are intelligent, have nothing to show. People are hardworking, but if you ask them at the end of the month, what is that to show? They have nothing to show. People live day in, day out. Somebody is a CEO, but can collect still bills from the shop. I'm going to kitabu ya deni. Amen. But it's a CEO. It is a power. It's not normal. Amen. It's not normal. People cannot stay in a relationship. It is not normal, my friends. Children are very intelligent, but the children can never be noticed. They are always sidelined, and you wonder what is happening. So you need power. And the book of Colossians chapter 1 verse 11 says, Colossians chapter 1 verse 11, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power. Amen.
Amen.
And to all patience and Lord somebody be joyful. So when you continue the attitude of prayer, you manifest his greatness. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Hallelujah. You will come to the reality of where your position. Amen. You access the manifold wisdom of God. And lastly, you walk in power. You walk in what? That's why I want you all to be encouraged in the ministry of prayer. Don't stop praying no matter what. It may not be seen today, but tomorrow is happening. Pray is like a seed. How many of us are ever trying to plant? When you plant, do you stop watering? No. So you continue watering by prayer, by faith. You continue what? Watering by prayer. By prayer. Now, I came and I told you, attitude is a position one assumes. Attitude is a position one assumes. What's your attitude towards prayer? Is prayer for men of God only? Is prayer for pastors only? No. The Bible says, Jesus says, men ought to pray. So prayer is a commandment. But the question is, what attitude do you carry towards prayer? I can't tell you about definitions of prayer. All of us know definitions of prayer. Amen. We have been taught many things about prayer. And I started teaching you about what affects you before, during, and after prayer. The attitude you carry before, during, and what? After prayer. And the first time I talked about the position of assurance. You must assure yourself when you're going to prayer. Tell your neighbor, assure yourself. Assurance is a state of being certain, of being confident. How many of us are sitting now when you, before you start to lift up the chair to be showing us for less? You said, is it true? But why you are sure it can carry your weight? Is it true? Now, if you go to prayer, you must go with that attitude of assurance. I am certain God will hear my prayer. Amen. You are certain. Most of us, we go to prayer when we are not certain or not confident. The book of Isaiah 59, verse 1. The book of Isaiah chapter 59, verse 1. The Bible says, behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened. it cannot save. Neither is it ear heavy that you cannot hear. God can save you. Amen. So you must walk with that assurance. God will save you.
Hallelujah.
His hand is not short. His ear is not deaf. So if God can hear, why are you not praying? Walk with assurance that God will hear your prayer. Amen. Assurance. How many of us go to the bathtub to check if there's water? But you just go in with the hot water, believing that water will come out. Is it true? Assurance. If you believe the water tank, how much more God? How many of us in the morning woke up and prayed for our phones to come out on? Father, you pray this phone be turned on in the name of Jesus before I use it. You are sure the phone is on, is it true? How? How can then when you go to prayer, you don't have that mentality? You should carry that mentality that God will hear you. Amen. Carry that mentality that the hand of God is not sure to save you.
Hallelujah.
So when you go to prayer, when you're in prayer and after prayer, remain assured. Remain what? Assured that the enemy will, if you don't remain assured, the enemy will take away the seeds of prayer.
Amen. Look at the book of 1 John chapter 5 verse 14. 1 John chapter 5 verse 14. 1 John chapter 5 verse 14. The Bible says, and this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask what?
Anything.
Say anything.
Amen.
Anything. According to his will, he heareth us.
Amen.
God hears you. Tell your neighbor, God hears you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Assurance. That's why I'm always sure God is hearing my prayer. I'm always sure this will work out. You understand me, I have assurance. Assurance. None of us woke up to check our phone. None of us woke up in the morning and check my finger. Is my finger working? Will it fall the bread in the morning? You are sure it is working, isn't you? How can I not sure that God will hear your prayer? So you must be sure. Attitude of what?
Assurance.
Amen.
Amen.
Last Sunday, I looked at the attitude, the position of casting your care to God. Number two, when you go to prayer, go casting your
care.
After you are sure God will hear, you cast your
care.
Most of us pray but manage God. To be sure if he heard us or he's doing something. You have prayed amen. After 2 days, God, did you hear my prayer? You know, I told you last week I need some hunger. Why are you managing God? When you find yourself managing God after prayer, then you don't have faith. I ask you, will you walk properly if someone is standing behind your back? You are saying, you know, be comfortable. Is it true? Then why are you standing behind the back of God? God, are you doing it? God, are you doing it? Cast your care to God. Cast what?
Yeah.
And when you say you're casting your care to God, you must be act like a fisherman. Act like what? A fisherman will take his rod, put his bait, throw the water, the rod, and the bait inside the lake or the ocean, whatever it is. Is it true? And he will wait. Is it true? Does he look around and say, are you there, bait? Does he do that? He waits. That's casting your care. Be sure that everything I told God, God will answer it. Amen. That means you put there, you are so sure that fish will come. Is it true? An ocean is a vast place, but no one can enter an ocean to know where the fish is located. You only throw the rod by faith. By what? By faith. Cast your care by faith. And faith is not going to manage. Faith is sure that wherever you cast it, it will respond. Is it true? Unless you go there, you have a digital frequency that you got the fish with. No, you don't have. Is it true? But they cast. How many of us have ever heard that there is a shortage of fish? But we have to lose these fish. And those fishermen wake up late at night in the middle of the night and they cast their rod there and they catch fish. Is it true? Then how much of more of your prayer? When you go to God, be sure God will hear your prayer. Cast your care to him. Daddy, this is my issue. I'm believing you for healing. I'm believing you for restoration. I'm believing you for a change of story. Then, after your prayer, let God answer. Amen.
Amen.
He will answer. I have seen prayers being answered. This week, even you're not going for that prayer this week here in the morning, you already received testimonies. Now, I'm telling you, if you have seen the testimonies, what makes you think that God will not answer your prayer? Stop managing God. Cast your
care.
Cast your care. The book of Mark, chapter 4, verse 19. When you don't cast your care, you will choke your prayer. You will do what? You have prayed for 1 hour.
Then you leave your prayer room and you have not cast your cares, you will choke your prayer. Why? Cares of the world will choke your prayer. Amen. So you cast your care, you don't stay with the care. Amen. Mark 4:19. And the cares of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust of things entered in, choke the what?
The word.
Choke what?
The word.
So even if you have the word of God that it will do for you, but if you not casting your care, you are choking what God is going to do for you. For example, if I tell you, if you tell me you buy me lunch, and every time I call you, will you buy me lunch? What will you do about the fifth thing? Even I'm not paying for you lunch. That's what you tell me. Is it true? Because why are you pursuing me? Are you buying me lunch? Are you buying me lunch? I already told you, I'll buy you what? Cares, chokes, whatever you are believing God for. Let God answer. Amen. Let God be God in your life. Amen.
Amen.
Trust Him. Rarely, even my sons can tell you, I rarely go back to the same prayer. After that prayer, I'm done. I'm not going to answer it. Is it true? One thing I do is start asking myself the kind of responsibilities I should take to make sure I see the answered prayer. Amen. So whenever you walk in chaos, you can't plan for what is ahead of you. That's what's happening. Most of us, we are praying God today and we are forgetting that God wants to do something better tomorrow. So we are just focused today. God, let my chicken lay eggs. Let my chicken lay eggs. But God wants you to have a farmer's choice plant. But you are not focusing. Chaos makes you think around the circumstances. You are talking about care avoids you to see ahead. It makes you just focus on the circumstances. And I told you there's a distinction, there's a difference between responsibility and care. There's a difference between responsibility and what?
Yeah.
In responsibility, you learn, but in care, you unlearn. You know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
In responsibility, what do? You learn. You learn what to do. Come says, learn of me. Take my yoke, for my burden is light. Is it true? But in care, you don't learn. You unlearn whatever you learn. Because you keep on changing positions. You keep on changing what? Keep on changing your faith. Keep on changing your desires because you are caring too much. Say, matter, what is needful to sit at the feet of Jesus? When you have too much many positions, you can never hear from God. God cannot bless you. God cannot change your story. But you learn responsibility. When you take responsibility, you learn what it takes for you to do. Look, I know. Look at the book of John chapter 6, verse 45. John 6:45. You can just say amen. John chapter 6, verse 45. Hallelujah. John 6:45, it is written in the prophets that they shall be all taught of God. Everyone therefore that hath and hath learned of the Father coming unto me. You must learn of the Father. Amen. So when Christ called you, He told you two things. Number one, learn of Him, in the book of Matthew 11:29. And number two, know who your Father is. If you know who your Father is, will you care? Now, if you are the child of the president and you want to eat fish, will you care where the fish will come from? Someone, who will care? You just tell them, I want fish. That is when you pray in the name of Jesus will deliver for you. Amen. The name of Jesus, what? Because by the name of Jesus, every knee must, every tongue must, on earth, above, and also beneath. So the name of Jesus is a delivery point for you. You understand what I'm talking about? If you are a child of a king, you want to drive a car, which car will you choose? Which car? A tuk-tuk? No, you see, it is not possible for you to accept that. Then why do you have a mentality God cannot answer you? The name of Jesus will deliver for you. You are a child of a king. And the king is above. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And said, the earth and the earth belong to you. So you cast your care. Tell your neighbor, I'm a child of a king. If I were you, tell your neighbor, if I were you, I'll buy you lunch tomorrow.
Yeah, you're a child of a king.
Cast your care. You see, if you don't know who you are and who you belong to in Christ, if you don't know who your Father is, your prayer, you never know how to cast your care to God. I know how to cast my care because I know who my Father is. My Father is well able. Amen. My Father is what? Well able. Is your Father well able? Are you sure?
Yes.
Then why don't you cast your care to God? My father is well able. Those are the two things when God called you, when he told you to get born again.
The first thing you're supposed to do was to learn his ways. And number two, for you to know your father in heaven. What your father is able to do for you. Amen. Hallelujah. And I taught you last Sunday how you cast your care during and after prayer. Number one, I said by speaking to the stones within you. By speaking what? Because concerns of the life will be there. Learn to speak to yourself. Amen. Speak to the stones within you. And I read for you the book of Mark chapter 4 verse 38. And they are walking and telling him, Master, you don't care, we perish. And Jesus woke up and spoke to the storm. And the storm came down. Mark chapter 4 verse 38. And I asked you a question. Why did the storm come down? And I told you it's because Jesus himself was at peace with himself. Hallelujah. When you're not at peace with yourself, no matter when you pray, it doesn't happen. When you do something when you're worried, does it go well? No. So why do you pray when you're worried that God will not answer you? And he said, peace be still. And the storm was peace. Is it true? Because Jesus himself knew how to speak to himself. Speak to yourself. When you feel worried, get an anchor scripture that you stand in. Hallelujah. Look for a scripture for yourself. When you feel things are not going right, you start saying the scripture aloud. You start saying what? When you say it aloud, you come to realize that your spirit man is coming down. Amen. Number two, I told you, develop your spirit man. Amen. And I told you, the spirit man is a portal. What you have here on earth is a result of where you're obtaining the spirit. So it's prayer and gives you access. So pray. Spirit man, develop your spirit man by reading the word of God, being in charge for service, being in a service unit. You understand what I'm talking about? It develops your spirit man. And number three, I told you, walk by faith, not by? 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. He says, for we walk by faith and not by? Amen. Mm-hmm. What do you see when you look at me? Are you using faith or sight? Amen. If you are using faith, you will notice I'm a very great man. Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you are using sight, you will be seeing blue. You know what the difference? So God is saying, don't walk by sight, walk by
faith.
Amen. Walk by faith. Walk by faith. That situation will change in the name of
Amen.
Jesus. Hallelujah. You shall never change the story. Any force that is bringing you down, it will eliminate you. When I met my son, Brother Dickens, the first time, there's something he was believing God for. And he thought I'd pray for him. I told him, go and pray for me. He asked me, I think you should be praying for me. I said, no, you go and pray for me. After he went to pray for me less than a week, that thing had gone. Hallelujah. What happened there? He didn't move by sight. He walked by. Do you believe God will answer you?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Don't look at your wallet and say, my wallet is empty. No. Your wallet is creating space for more. Amen.
Amen.
You see, it's language that matters. You know what I'm talking about? You see, your mentality matters here. It's faith. Hallelujah. I never tell people I don't have money. Just say my money is engaged. It's what? It's engaged. It will mature. They say the banker's check will mature. Is it true? Also, your money will mature. In many places. It shall come down. Amen. Hallelujah. The island never belongs to Jesus. It's a same and gold are mine. Hallelujah. So I belong to someone who owns same and gold. Can I be poor? Like why you have a poor mentality? You see, all this is my faith. My faith. That's why I cast my care. I know my God has applied all my
needs.
Now if you know that, why do you walk as if you can't apply for you? There's a day I was still growing the faith. I don't know what this man is. I went to Saropa's family hotel. Hallelujah. Amen. I sat there and ordered water. I took water. I said I was waiting for someone. I was waiting for myself. Hallelujah. After taking my water, I left. I was in a hotel. What is this hotel for who? It was for who? Mentality. I knew one day I should let this place. To God be the glory, I've got a good hotel. Amen. But you started by faith. Sometimes just enter a place. Do you know what I mean? Don't buy the bottle of water. I'm going to say if you haven't buy it, hallelujah. Exercise your faith. Exercise what? You have been doing something with my wife. You have been living up for a house. Sometimes we call this big place companies. We have said how much is the house. And they end up calling us and saying, keep quiet. We will call them later. Amen. We are exercising our faith. What the hell they talk? They tell you the figures in millions or the thing has 22 million. You can't live for 18 million. They're talking about what are we doing? Exercising our? Because when I have such conversation for such kinds of figures, that's how I think. But if I always think about 20,000, 5,000, that's how I also. So your faith level is a result of the information you have. The Bible says the spirit of truth shall remind you. What will it remind you if your heart is empty? Will it remind you anything? Walk by? By faith. How we got here? By faith. They said there's no way we can get here. Is it true? I tell them no. By faith. What is your faith? What is the status of your faith? And lastly, I told you, sit under a man of God continuously. I showed you the book of 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 15 to 17. Gehazi came out and told Elisha, oh, the Syrians have surrounded us. And the Elisha prayed, Lord, open the eyes of the lad. Is it true? And when God opened the eyes of the lad, he saw, wow, we are surrounded by multitudes. They're not talking about. Sometimes in Christianity, you can't walk by yourself. That's why God puts men of God in your life. Are we clear? Amen?
Amen.
Some of us have never seen little miracles, but since you came here, you saw miracles happen. You never knew miracles can happen. That's what I'm telling you. The day you see a blind man opening his eyes, that's when you believe God is there. Next to you, you see a blind man opening his eyes and tell you, how are you? He said, can you see me? He said, yes, sir. Sit under a man of God. It will build your capacity in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Now, today we look at the position of persuasion. Tell me about persuasion.
Persuasion.
What is persuasion? Amen. Persuasion is an opinion taken from the point of assurance. You hear that? An opinion taken from a point of what? I am assured that God will hear my prayer. You understand? But I must also be persuaded. And most of us are assured, but we are not persuaded. That's the problem. You understand? It's an opinion taken from a point of assurance. Assurance and persuasion are not the same thing. I can assure you, but you may never be persuaded. You know that? But there's no way I can persuade you and fail to be assured. And most of us leave prayer at the place of assurance because the man of God said, no, be persuaded also.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Amen. Persuasion is from you, not from them. God can tell you to heal you. That's assurance. But do you believe you'll be healed? That is persuasion. You know what I'm talking about? Assurance. You know what I'm talking about? In assurance, you are certain in your mind. In persuasion, you are acting on what you are certain about. Hallelujah. You get what I'm talking about?
Yes.
Assurance, you are certain in your mind. In persuasion, you are acting on what you are assured of. Hallelujah. The book of James chapter 2, verse 17. I'm not going to die. James chapter 2, verse 17. I pray by today, before you leave here, you will be persuaded God will come through for you in the name of Jesus Christ. Be persuaded. James chapter 2, verse 17. James chapter 2, verse 17. Are we there? James chapter 2, if I just say a louder amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He said, even so, faith, if it has no works, is dead, being alone. So faith is an assurance of this hope for. And the evidence of this don't seem, is it true? But what is persuasion? Persuasion is the acting on the word you have received. You get the difference now? Assurance is the faith obtained. Persuasion is the faith acted upon. Are we clear? Assurance is what? The faith obtained. And persuasion is the faith acted upon. Faith is the assurance of things of. But faith without action is dead. You can only act on the faith you believe if you are persuaded. So it's not enough to be assured that God will heal you. You must be persuaded God will heal you. Do you understand what I'm saying? God's word is true. God's word will never change. But you must be what? That's what I prayed to someone. I said, do you believe God will do? You must believe. Because I can build for you the scripture, but the scripture don't want to heal you. It's how you act on the word of God. You understand what I'm talking about? Acting on the word of God. Act on the word of God. That is persuasion. But most of us only work at the platform of persuaders. After you have prayed, what next? You don't want God's supply. Is it true? Next, what do you do? Go look for opportunities for supply. Amen. Amen. Don't sit there and say, God will supply all my needs. How? This men in Philippians chapter 4, when they say God shall supply all our needs, they are given to Paul, they are given to a man of God. And Paul prayed a prayer, they had acted on faith. Hallelujah.
Amen.
They had acted on
faith.
Acted on faith. Persuasion. Are you persuaded? Most of us, we pray, but we're not persuaded. God will do it. Ask me, I'm always persuaded. That's why I'm not working with him. I always tell him, do we agree? We have agreed. Done. You're not even talking about it. It is done. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm not going ahead to check on it. It will happen. Because I am persuaded, I'm not only assured. You are asking me the difference right here. Be persuaded. Be what?
Persuaded.
Don't be assured only. After being assured by the word of God, be persuaded. Are you persuaded that you will prosper? Are you sure?
Yes.
Are you persuaded that you shall live in good places?
Yes.
You shall have good cars?
Amen.
That you shall go to good schools?
Yes.
Are you persuaded? Don't only be assured. It's not bad to see from the word of God. That's a good assurance. But be
persuaded.
I said, assurance is what? Assurance is the faith obtained. But persuasion is the faith acted. Faith is the assurance of his offer. Hebrews chapter 11. All of us know that. Is it true? But are you persuaded? I am persuaded that this church will grow in leaps and bounds. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I am persuaded. When you started meeting with him, three of us, in that small garden, no room, nowhere to sit. We had borrowed chairs. Everything was borrowed, even the table. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But see, years have come by. See how far we have come. See where we have come. Persuasion, it was not assurance. We were persuaded. Be persuaded that God will come through for you in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
Now, Romans chapter 4, verse 18 to 21. I'll show you something. Be persuaded. Amen. Be
persuaded.
You must persuade yourself. Like all of you are looking at me now, some of you are persuaded that I'm a man of God. Now you stop being assured. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. It's by fellowship. Yeah, persuaded. Now, this guy is true. Are you in Romans chapter 4? If I just say amen.
Amen.
Romans chapter 4, verse 18 to 21. I want us to follow. I want to read and follow. Amen. Amen. This scripture is powerful. Romans chapter 4, verse 18 to 21. Are we there, all of us?
Yes.
Now, they say, who against hope believed in what? That he might become a father of many nations. According to which was spoken, so shall the seed be. So Abraham was assured he'd be a father of many. Now let us continue verse 19. And not being weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100 years, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promises of God through what? Unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God.
Amen.
And being what?
Fully persuaded.
What was he? Fully
persuaded.
That which he had promised, he was able to. Now, will God tell Abraham to go and meet his wife? No, is it true? God has only told Abraham, you will be a father of many nations. 100 years old, no child. Assurance. Now, it is Abraham and Sarah to take responsibility to meet each other that they may conceive. Am I saying the truth? Acting on the word. That is persuasion. Acting on the word. Don't hear the word only. Act on it. People who are hearers and not doers of the word, they get frustrated as Christians. Act on the word. Act on the word. Abraham was assured, yet he was not weak in faith. Then he fully persuaded himself. This man of God cannot fall down and die. His word shall not return to him empty. Oh my God, Lord, by you with the clothes. But Sarah was persuaded. That's why we don't return for you. Are you persuaded God will heal you? Are you persuaded to bless you? Are you persuaded to succeed? Your level is a choice of persuasion of faith. You know what I'm saying? Your level is a choice of persuasion of faith. I told you I grew my business on 500 Kenyan shillings. 500. Look at where we are right now. Since I knew Jesus, I took steps. Hallelujah. Not only hearing the word, acting on the word. Act on the word. And it's too many about acting on the word. Most of us, we have heard so much of the gospel, but we don't act on that word. So when I go on prayer, I tell God, look at my actions. Hallelujah. And go back to my actions. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But you're praying, you're not acting. Where is that prayer going to? Persuasion makes what you are assured of to come to pass. You understand? Persuasion makes what you are sure of come to. You see, you can pray for a sick person, but if they are not persuaded to be healed immediately, they must be persuaded. Be persuaded. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Be what?
Persuaded.
Because when you are persuaded, you will take what we call corresponding
action.
Corresponding what? All of you are here because you're persuaded I'm a man of God. If I was not a man of God, none of you would be here. Is it true? Did you come to see a janitor? No. You are persuaded. Is it true? What will you tell? Why will you tell a neighbor that come to church? You are persuaded. You are not assured in it. You are persuaded? Are you persuaded God will change your story? Are you persuaded? Are you sure? Next year, time like this, where will you be? Where will you be? Persuasion. It's very important. When you go to prayer, be persuaded God will answer your prayer. Amen.
Amen.
Not only Yeshua, be what? So what does persuasion do? Number one. What does persuasion do? Number one. Persuasion makes one take steps as one. You understand? It makes one take steps as one with or with whom. If I'm persuaded I'm going somewhere with Brother Oliver, I will go with him as one. You understand what I'm about? As one. It makes you take steps as one. Amos 3:3. Can two walk together and in agreement? No. So in the book of Amos 3:3, it tells us, you will only walk together unless we are in agreement. When I'm in agreement with you and I walk with you, please, I'm persuaded that you're the right person to walk with. So if you walk with that word of God, then it means you're persuaded that word will come to pass. Most of us don't walk with the word of God. That's why you walk by sight. Which word are you walking with after prayer? Which word are you walking with during prayer? Which word are you walking with before prayer? Which word are you standing with? If I ask you, you are believing God for financial breakthrough. Which scripture are you standing with? You don't have, then how will you see financial breakthrough? You are believing God for healing. Which word are you standing on with? The book of Isaiah says, when the enemy comes like a flood, the speech shall leave a word. How will you leave a standard if you are not persuaded? You understand what I'm saying? Persuasion makes you walk, take steps as one. You and the word of God, you become one. You understand what I'm about? You and the word of God become what?
One.
Look at this, 2 Chronicles chapter 18, verse 1 to 3. 2 Chronicles chapter 18, verse 1 to 3. The Bible says, now Jehoshaphat had riches and honor in abundance and joined affinity with her. 2 Chronicles chapter 18, verse 1 to 3. Verse 2, and says, and after certain years he went down to Ahab to Samaria, and Ahab killed sheep and oxen for him in abundance, and for the people that he had with him, and persuaded him to go up with him to Ramoth Gilead. And have king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, wilt thou go with me to Ramoth Gilead? And he answered, I am as thou art, and my people as thy people, and we will be in thee in the war. They were together, they were persuaded that they are the right partners. Be persuaded about the more close one than God? Which is the closest one of God in your heart?
Amen.
I have a close friend, my best friend. Which is the best one of God in your heart? That's why your prayer life is shaking. Amen. Psalms 127 says what? It is in which wake up early and he was in the bed. Also, unless the Lord build the city, the builders will be ruined. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the watchmen watch over it. What? The way you have a best friend, I'm the best one. Hallelujah. The way you have a close friend, I'm the close. Why? Most of us don't have scriptures in our hearts. That's why issues are choking our life. That's why you go to prayer, you're not sure God will have your prayer. Which is your closest one? Which is your closest one? Which one do you stand with in the days of trials? Because trials will come. I'm asking the truth. Which one will you follow with? Or will you succumb? Will you cry? Will you say, God has been forsaken me? No, God, I cannot forsake you. Hallelujah. The Lord, the Bible says, I've gone all out. I've never seen the righteous forsaken. Why should God forsake you? Number two, what does possession do? Possession makes people testify on your behalf. Amen. All of us know God, my friends. I'm asking the truth. How do you know God, my friends? Because you know when there's a God, my football, everyone in the city avoids going to town. Is it true?
Mm-hmm.
You are persuaded. You can say, hey, there's a football match between AFC and God, my don't pass that road. Yeah? Pass that road. Persuasion. People, when you're persuaded, people will testify. Persuasion makes you walk in faith and give people that say that man is a person of church, is a church God. You're talking about that is a Christian. Most of us, we are not persuaded. That's why anyone can say anything concerning your life. Are you persuaded? Look at this. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 9. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 9. When you are persuaded, you shall succeed, people will testify. People will testify how good you are. Hallelujah. People will testify. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 9. Because I say amen. He says, but beloved, we are persuaded better things of you and the things that accompany salvation. Do with us speak. When they look at you, what are they persuaded about your life? What who you follow is a result of what you are persuaded about them. Do you know that? If none of this persuaded about you, there's no way you can be here. If you are persuaded about you, you will continue. You're talking about persuasion is what people say about you. What are they persuaded about? Some people can misinterpret you, which is normal, okay? People can say anything they want to say, you understand? But what is the merging testimony? In that percentage of brackets testimonies, what do people say you are? Are you a man of faith? Are you a woman of faith? Are you the person who will be called to pray on issues? Or you are the complainer? God, you'll be praying because God will not answer. God will answer in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Be persuaded. And number three, it makes one reason. When you are persuaded, you will reason. You will what? You will reason. You just not follow like, even sheep has common sense. Hallelujah. You just don't follow. You just reason. You reason on everything. Most people don't reason. That's why they're not persuaded. When you are persuaded, you reason. But then this way, this guy is talking. Then this guy is praying. What does he know that I don't know? What's he talking about? You end up what? Reason. Why did God say if you pray in this manner? Why did not God say we pray in this other manner? Amen. Because God would have changed the Lord's prayer, is it true? He would have prayed it backwards. Why did he pray the other way? Persuasion makes you what? Acts chapter 18, verse 4. Acts 18, verse 4. And the Bible says, and he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks. Reasoning brings persuasion. Hallelujah. Reasoning brings what?
Persuasion.
When you reason, you will be persuaded. Most of us are not reasoning with the word of God. That's why we are not persuaded we'll be healed. We don't think we're not persuaded that we'll be transformed. That's why you're not persuaded that your future is greater. When is the last time you took the word of God and reasoned with it? When is the last time? Listen to me. Bible study is not a matter of reading Genesis to Revelation. No. is a matter of you knowing who God is. Did you understand? You don't need a book to finish and then it's not finished. You can finish a book but your head is empty. How many of us remember his story that he learned from two? And evidence of reading a book and finish. Unless someone can challenge me here, who can remember? Now that's how we handle the word of God. All of you are laughing, it's true. Amen? Don't do that. The Bible is a part of you to reason. Take the word of God and reason. Why did you write this thing? You said, by your strength I am healed. I, 1 Peter 2, verse 24. By says, I was healed. And if I was healed, why am I suffering pain?
Yes.
I touch my healing in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Lord, you said in your word, I am
healed.
Now you walk like that, I am healed, I am healed, I am healed. You tell me after 1 week, should be healed.
Yes.
It is metaphor. But if you're surrounded with people who speak doubt, what will happen? You won't be healed. They will kill their faith in you. That's why when you listen to the word of God, you spend time with people who fear God also. You spend time in church. Why? It changes your mentality. Hallelujah. As we conclude today, what does it take to start in walking in persuasion? What does it take for you to start walking in persuasion? What does it take? What does it what? Number one, by continuity in the word and his presence. By continuity means what? And is you be in self-fellowship, be in a love center somewhere. Hear the word of God on Saturday. Sunday be in church for prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Monday be in prayer. Thursday come for the meeting by continuing. You understand? Sometimes life is busy that you may never get time to read the word by yourself. Is it true? But in this fellowship, you learn up reading. Continue the word and his presence. Proverbs chapter 25, verse 15. It says, by long forbearing is a prince persuaded by long. In continuity, a prince is taught that's how you behave as a, to be a king. Why you're not living like a king? Because you're not continuing to the word of God that makes you want to behave like a prince. You know what I'm saying? Why you're not behaving like a king is because you're not continuing the word of God that makes you to become a prince and a king. If the Bible says, he are God and the children of the monster. If you don't know, you will die at the end. If God says you are a God, then why do you doubt yourself? You only take the mentality of a prince when you are taught about the prince. Is it true? You are a princess. No child can hardly can take you anywhere. No one can just address you and you want to address. No one can just treat you the way you want to treat you. But if you don't know, they will mistreat you. Who can go and slap the child of Mr. President Uru? I can take you, but no one can take you. Who can do that? You see, you cannot even think like that. Why? The child has not told me anything. Because he has been raised with a mentality of a child of the president. Is it true? When you are not raised with that continuity that you are a child of a king, you will be doubtful in prayer. That's why you must continue in his presence and in the word of God. Continue. Acts chapter 20, verse 32. I commend you the word of his grace that is able to build you up and give you what? An inheritance. Much shorter though. Yes, I commend you. You can't be all off in church. You must be continue. Continue. Number two. When you hear from men, you recognize as your authority. When you hear what? From men, you recognize as your authority. If you don't have an authority, you don't have direction. You don't have authorization. Amen. No authority, no authorization. That's why Jesus is the authority. And at the name of Jesus, we have authorization to get whatever we need to get. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Who is your authority in heaven and your earth? Who is your man of God? Who's your pastor? Who's your teacher? Who? What I know is the result of who? Who is my authority? Do you know that? How I talk is a result of my authority. A man who's born to be a lion and spends time with a sheep will never know he's a lion. Do you know that?
Yes.
Now, do you know you belong to the tribe of Lion of Judah? Do you know that? Now, who is your authority? Now, when you have an authority in your life, the person who speaks in your life, the person you recognize, you will always be persuaded. Are you understanding about? Because you learn from them. Look at the book of Matthew, chapter 27, verse 20-21. This is a negative report, but it's too good for you to see. Matthew chapter 27, verse 20-21. Matthew 27, verse 20-21. Are you learning something?
Yes.
Amen? Who is your authority? Who is your authority?
Some of us don't even have a man of God that we answer to. We just live our life. I'm a Christian.
Matthew chapter 27, verse 20-21. Are you there?
Yes.
He said, but the chief priests and the elders persuaded you. So who persuades you is your authority. If I tell you, you will prosper and have your authority, you will believe. You know you've been persuaded.
Yes.
But you have no one who's speaking over your life. That's why you're not persuaded. Who speaks over your life? Who do you answer to? Amen. And you are persuaded, the man, and they should ask for Barabbas. These guys were against Jesus. And Barabbas was a thief. Was a prominent, famous thief. But the elders, the chiefs, told the multitudes, let us ask for Barabbas. And they were persuaded Barabbas is the right person. These guys had no sense. They followed the sense of authority. And when you have an authority in your life, it determines what you are authorized to do.
Yes.
You know what I'm talking about? Where you go is a result of who is leading you. Where you sleep is where you are, is a result of who is taking you there. Some of us will enjoy cool life because of who we follow. But some of us will never see that good life because of who we don't follow. You know what I'm talking about? Persuasion starts from authority. And the governor answered and said unto them, whether the 12 will lead, that I release you. And they say, Barabbas. Imagine everyone shouted Barabbas. And some of them even never knew Barabbas. Because of who? Authority. Authority has a force in making you be persuaded. You know, I have told him you'll prosper. He has always believed you'll prosper. So even if you tell him you don't prosper, he said, my father said, I'll prosper. Do you hear that? Now, that is not what you call force of persuasion. Now, when I tell you, you will pray and God will answer your prayer and I teach you how, you know you believe that?
Yes.
Most of us used to come and pray that believing if you pray, our prayer will hit the ceiling. Are you praying to the ceiling or praying to God? You just never knew how to pray. And the Bible says, the disciples told Jesus, teach us how to
pray.
That's why you come to church to be taught these things. Number three, who have you chosen to believe? Do you choose to believe what people say out there, or do you choose to believe the word of God? Now, belief is a choice, okay? Faith comes, but belief is a
choice.
You hear that? Faith comes by hearing, but belief is a I choose to believe. I choose to believe. I choose to believe that all of you shall be blessed. Amen. I choose to believe. That's why I'm in prayer every day. I choose to believe that none of you shall remain the same way.
Yeah.
I don't care how you came, but I know your latter shall be greater.
Amen.
Amen. I choose to believe that none of us shall suffer. Amen. I choose to believe. But faith coming by hearing. Now look at this. 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 12. Who do you choose to believe? 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 12. The Bible says, for which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed. Amen. And I'm persuaded that he's able to keep that which I have committed unto him against this
day.
I have chosen to believe. Do you believe you shall be healed? Do you believe you shall be transformed? Do you believe of an open door? Do you believe a change of story for your family? Do you believe? Hey, no, most of us don't believe. You just hear faith. You don't believe. You need to choose. I shall all this addiction and overcome it in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Ah, I believe, I believe, I believe. You choose. No one will teach you to believe. You choose to, but we will teach you the word of faith. You know what I'm talking about? Faith is taught, but belief is chosen.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm talking about? Faith is what? But believe in God. I can teach you faith, but you can choose to believe in me. You understand that? That's why you can go to church, no problem. But you choose to believe someone. You choose, you decide. I will believe in this person. is that person? How is your relationship with that person? You chose to believe. Is it true? They told you they are from Italy. You did not cross check. But you just continued the relationship. Then later you say, how did you know he's coming from Italy? You chose to believe. Hallelujah. Did you ask him for the ID? Who asked here? When you started dating, ask for a partner for the ID. No, is it true? You chose to believe. You chose to?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they are Ugandans and you thought they are Kenyans. You choose to?
Yeah.
I'm telling you, give you proof. You choose to believe. So, you can choose to believe that you will be transformed. You can choose to believe that you shall not remain the same level. Will you believe?
Yes.
Amen. Number four, mentorship. Who is your mentor? Now, this one is different from who you hear. Who is your authority? This is your mentor. You can have many mentors, but only one father, okay?
Yeah.
You can have many, but only one?
One.
Yeah. Listen to me, I am from the witness family. There's no way I can change. I can never deny my father. My father can only deny me. Is it true? But I even for him to be happy because they will ask, look at his ears. It looks like he's, is it true? Who's your mentor? Who mentors you?
2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 5. 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 5. The Bible says, when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother, Lois, amen, and thy mother, Eunice, and I'm persuaded that in thee also. Mentorship. Do you see the power of mentorship? So the grandmother mentored the grandmother called Lois, mentored the mother called Eunice. The mother called Eunice mentored the son called Timothy. You are talking about who's your mentor? You are as persuaded as how you are mentored. How much you know the word of God is a result of where you sit. You are talking about how far you pursue God is a result of where you go through. How much you know of the word of God is where you sit. You hear what I'm saying? Some of us have not seen here for many months, but you've already seen the hand of God. Is it true? Why are you seeing the hand of God? Mentorship. Because the man, father, your friend, say, go here for self-love centers, you're going. Go here for prayers, you're going. And you're saying, that it has nothing to do with me, it has to do with God. Following instructions from the Father. Amen. Number five, say choice. You choose to be persuaded. Amen. Romans chapter 14, verse 5. It says, one man estimates another day above another, one estimates every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. Choose. Will you choose to be persuaded from today when you go to prayer, God will answer your prayer?
Yes.
Will you choose to be persuaded?
Yes.
How many will be persuaded at me that God will answer my prayer? Hallelujah. So gather your family, pray, believe in God. Hallelujah.
When I started a love relationship with my wife, she used to tell me, why do you build big budgets sometimes and what we have does not reflect the budget? It's my faith. I'm persuaded that we get there. Hallelujah. I have no problem making a budget for 100 million, but then if you ask me, I can make it. You understand? The problem is you. The one who made it is okay with it. You understand? Because I'm fully, I made a choice to be persuaded.
Think I can't be afraid to budget for that BMW, man. Budget for it. You understand?
Yeah.
If it doesn't come next year, it will still come. Amen.
Amen.
But every year, let it be in your budget. Choose to be persuaded. But if you're living for money, make us of it. You understand? No, that's your level of thinking. Choose to be persuaded that God will hear my prayer. That tomorrow I shall have my own shop. Tomorrow I shall have my own business. Tomorrow I shall have my own. You understand? Choose to be persuaded.
How many of us have passports? Choice. You don't believe to go outside the country? Why you born? The Bible says you shall be witness not only here. Is it true? To Samaria. Do you know where Samaria is? Where is Samaria? Right? Israel. And to the uttermost part of the world. Do you know like this? Why are you thinking like a local champion? This is your persuasion. Are you persuaded one day you shall let her play? Or I just believe because as much as I use a mash pass to Mombasa, I'm okay. Mash is comfortable enough. Amen. It's your level of persuasion. Choice. Choice. Choose after that in the name of Jesus. And lastly, love. Love. You can never be persuaded unless you love.
If you love someone, you'll be persuaded that the right person. Is it true? I know my sons love me. I know my daughters love me. That's why they are persuaded that the right person is in their life. Love. You can, if you love someone, you'll be persuaded it's the right person. Love. Galatians 5, 6 to 8. Galatians 5, 6 to 8. Amen? Galatians 5, 6 to 8. I says, for in Jesus Christ, neither circumcision, I violate anything. Amen. Nor uncircumcision. Galatians chapter 5, verse 6 to 8. For in Jesus Christ, neither what? Circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision. But faith, which worketh by love. If you don't love, you can never be persuaded. Do you love God? If you love God, you'll be persuaded God will answer you. Why are you not sure that God will answer you? Because you don't love God. You treat God like a visitor. Even some of you respect more of your toilet than the God. Even you knock in the toilet, you get time in the toilet, you don't get time to go. And you're living every day. Love God. If you love God, you'll be persuaded. And he said, ye did run well. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth? This persuasion cometh not of him that calleth you. God will never persuade you. Your love for him is what will persuade that you love for him. How many of us love God? That's the question. How much do you love God, the things of God? When you love the things of God, you will be persuaded God cannot disappoint you. You love your wife, that's why you don't pray for her to cook. Or have you ever seen a husband bring the father cause my wife to cook at night? But you get food, is it true? Even they ask you, do you want to go to shower? Love. Love can make you do things, is it true? If you love God, you'll be persuaded God will answer you. If you don't love God, you'll never be persuaded. And the love of God starts by you giving your life to Jesus Christ. It doesn't matter how many times, if your life is not right, it's not occupied to be dedicated. You understand me about? It does not cost you. If you want a new life, you must choose to love God. And it's not for the point of salvation. Amen. The point of what?
Salvation.
Amen.
Amen.
Are you blessed? Are you blessed?
Yes.
And I said 5-6 things that will make you start working persuasion. I said continue in the word and his presence. Number 2, say when you hear from the men of God who you recognize as your authority. Number 3, when you have chosen to believe. Number 4, mentorship. Number 5, choose. And lastly, love. Amen.
Amen.
Now, before I go first, I conclude the service today. Today is an anointing service. Amen.
Amen.
And before I minister the anointing and I do my altar call, I want to share with you something very briefly. What is the anointing? Because some of us maybe you have never administered the anointing. We don't know what the anointing is. What is the anointing? Because I don't believe in ignorance. Hallelujah. The book of Hebrews, it says, the Bible says, Isaiah 4:6, where people perish because of lack of
knowledge.
No, but we need knowledge. Amen. Now, why do we administer the anointing well as a ministry? Amen. Amen. Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 24 to 25. Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 24 to 25. All of us who are watching online, you can get your anointing bottom or for point of contact. Amen. But why do we minister the anointing? Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 24 to 25. If I just say amen.
Amen.
Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 24 to 25. And he said, and of Asher he said, let Asher be blessed with children, and let him be acceptable to his brethren. And let him keep his foot in what?
All
I was to minister that anyone who's being rejected will be accepted in the name of Jesus Christ. Anyone believing God for a partner, anyone believing God for an opportunity, by the all, he'll break any embargo in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He says, no, let his brethren, let him be accepted. Some people are not married not because they are not married, it's not because there's a force is making them not be accepted. But the anointing one, we break that job. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You're in business. People are not buying from your shop. Why? Because there's an embargo. By the anointing, we break it in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So we minister the anointing so that we can be blessed. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So that we can be what?
Amen.
Number 2. So that we can be acceptable. So that we can be what?
Acceptable.
Wherever we go, we are liked. We are loved. I know all of you love me by force. Amen. You have no choice. You have seen my face. You say, I like his face. Hallelujah. The anointing. Amen.
the anointing. Amen. Number three, so that you can be like iron and brass. Amen. Nothing can, any incantation from the pit of hell, any challenge from your village, any person who says anything contrary cannot affect your life. Amen.
Amen.
And lastly, so that you can be strengthened. Amen. You understand?
Yes.
So what can we do, the anointing, or we administer the Spirit of God in your life? Amen. By faith. By
faith.
You can see that in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 16 verse 13. 1 Samuel chapter 16 verse 13. And then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon. See, so it was by faith. It was a normal anointing oil. And when we administered, the Spirit of God came upon.
Yes.
You understand what I'm talking about?
Yes.
By faith. By faith. 1 Samuel 16, 12. You can see that on your own time. You can read it. 16, 13, sorry. Number two, so that you can set a mark on your life. Any strong arrow, any person who's cursing you will not have effect on your life. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
1 Kings chapter 1, verse 39. You can see that. So a mark can be set on your life. You can be exempted. 1 Kings chapter 1 verse 39. And Zadok the priest took an horn of oil out of the tabernacle and anointed Solomon. And they blew the trumpet and the people said, God save King Solomon. The anointing one. So whatever we are doing is not what is not scriptural, it's scriptural. We are talking about is scriptural. Number three, so that your cup can run over. Your cup can do what? Psalms chapter 23 verse 5. Psalms 23 verse 5. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with what?
Oh.
And all when I am anointed with oil, then my cup runneth
over.
You shall overflow with revelation, with ideas, with blessings, with opportunities in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And number four, you become glad than your fellows. Amen. Especially joy is good. Amen. Now, do you understand what you're doing, anointing? Because it's scriptural. So today, I'm believing God to set for free anyone who's having anything that are carrying their life that is limiting them. Amen.
Amen.
Today, by the anointing, they shall be free in the name of
Jesus.
Yeah.
Anyone who's been struggling with their weight, they can't even put down any addiction, any force, by the anointing, it shall be broken. Amen.
Amen.
Can you be on a future self making that prayer? Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord. God, today, being the anointing service, I take you. What do you want God to do for you? In the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray over this all in the name of Jesus Christ. Open your mouth and pray. Everyone who's there at home, lift up your voice and start praying. Lord, you hear me? I'm missing God. I take my healing. I take my restoration. I break every yoke in the name of Jesus. I shall not remain the same way. Lord, I shall become acceptable. My time of salvation is here. I'm receiving a change of story. I'm receiving a change of story. I am being redeemed. I am being free from every yoke, every burden, everything that is making me not to be settled. Anything that's making me not be married. Everything that's making me not succeed in business. Everything that's taking away my joy. Everything that's making me have financial issues. Oh Lord, by this anointing, today I break it. Open the mouth and pray. Pray, 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 pray. Now by the anointing, today, Lord, my cup shall run over. My cup shall run over. Open your mouth and pray. Oh, every head bow, every eye closed before. If you're there online, every head bow, every eye closed. If you're there, you want to be born again, why don't you lift up your hand? If you're right there and return here with us physically, you want to dedicate your life to Jesus, or you want to be born again, lift up your right hand. And if you're there online, lift up your right hand wherever you are, by the grace of God. Then put your left hand on your chest. Then say after me, wherever you are, say after me, say, Lord Jesus, I come before you. I accept you as my Lord and personal Savior. Today, I confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I'm born again in Jesus' name. Father, for everyone here who has made that prayer, I pray for a blessing. Everyone online, Lord, a blessing in the name of Jesus Christ. Let them be established in the faith. Let them be established in the faith. Anything they were are fighting, Lord.
Yes.
Lord, I say fight for them. Lord, set them free for it. In the name of Jesus. From now henceforth, you are born again. Congratulations. If you got born again online, please write to us so that we can minister to you. And for those of us who may got born again physically here, please see me immediately after, see Brother Lucas immediately after the service in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Are you set for the anointing oil?
Yes.
Now open your mouth and start praying. Father, I pray for this oil in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we take it by faith. We believe you, Lord. By this anointing, today every embargo shall be broken. Everything, Lord, that is going. As I put my hands on this oil, I pray the grace of God watching upon my life to go through it. And Lord, by the anointing, oh Lord, as I wear someone another devil, and the spirit came upon me, let the spirit come upon everyone who's here, Lord, setting them free, Lord, delivering them, giving them victory in the name of Jesus. The battle they have been fighting, but they shall not fight it. Lord, these Egyptians that we see, they shall not see those Egyptians anymore. In the name of Jesus, Lord, they are blessed. They are preserved. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Hallelujah. So you just take prayerfully, just take a step as come and give your finger on the oil, anoint yourself, go back in your seat and pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Master, so far, you can just take a step of faith, anoint yourself, and open your mouth. Wherever you are online, anoint yourself, start praying for yourself. What do you desire God to do for you? Or pray for yourself in the name of Jesus Christ. Latuzo, open your mouth and start praying as you anoint yourself, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. Let's say Let's say what you want to see with this anointing. Lord God, anoint myself. I pray, Lord, for this change of story. Open your mouth and pray for yourself. Lord, we give you praise in Jesus' mighty name. Father, for everyone who has anointed themselves, I pray every yoke is broken. Except by the anointing, every yoke shall be broken. Any yoke of lack and want, any yoke of poverty, any yoke of rejection, every yoke that is now making them to be settled in their own home, Lord, any yoke of sickness and disease is broken today in the name of Jesus. Lord, thank you. We appreciate you. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Are you happy?
Yeah.
Are you exalted? Yeah. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. You may have your sister, Mother of Christ Jesus. Thank you for watching us online. God bless you and preserve you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Amen.